The Psychology of Final Fantasy, Surpassing the Limit Break. Edited by Anthony M. Bean, PhD. Narrated by Gabriella Pitchford. To all of the Final Fantasy gamers, this book is for you. Without your love of the series, we would not have been able to make this happen. Also, to those who are needing to know that video games affect video gamers in positive ways, let this book give you the insight required. And thank you to the families that have allowed us time and effort to complete these chapters and games again for the book. Your sacrifice does not go unnoticed. Forward. In 1987, Hironobu Sakaguchi penned Final Fantasy, what was to be the last video game Square, later known as Square Enix, would ever release. More than three decades later, it almost feels like fate that the franchise would be graced with its name, for it has constantly preserved against the odds, defying and surpassing the limits expected to break it. It is impossible to measure the cultural influence Final Fantasy has had on the video game industry and video game players. However, there are a few known statistics to gain a better idea. It has sold over 154 million copies to date. Final Fantasy XIV was once a commercial disaster that was remade and, as of this time of writing, is now its most successfully, massively multiplayer online entry, with over 18 million registered players. Its most famous entry, Final Fantasy VII, catapulted the once-niche Japanese role-playing game genre into a global force. It's been referenced throughout practically every artistic media myriad ways. There are even two professional wrestlers, Kenny Omega and Chris Sabin, who created their namesakes after reoccurring Superboss Omega Weapon and Final Fantasy VI's Sabin Rene Figaro, respectfully. But culture is created and defined by individual people, and there's no way to trace the infinite amounts of ways Final Fantasy has impacted millions from its inception. It is the franchise that unexpectedly saved Square Enix from bankruptcy. Its creative foundation has inspired countless individuals to work in the industry, forming some of the most famous characters in video game landscape. It has birthed dozens of multidimensional female characters who have served as role models for several generations of girls and women in the storytelling medium of video games, which tends to offer scarce representation for them. It has even softened the rigid ideas of masculinity that are pervasive in Western media. People have found lasting friendships and love, formed communities, and built families through their love of Final Fantasy. Perhaps it only makes sense then to have such a difficulty defining Final Fantasy's cultural impact. For what does it mean to be a Final Fantasy? There are so many commonalities among these games, such as reoccurring creatures, figures, and gameplay elements, among the fresh and ever-shifting changes made to storylines, combat systems, and protagonists. So, how does one define this series? Many stories have transcended in their original mediums by expanding to cinema, literature, and TV. But Final Fantasy has achieved what so much art and humanity dreams of accomplishing, to find success in undefined potential. Several video game franchises have stood the passage of time, both in cultural and technological sense, but few have reinvented themselves in a way that Final Fantasy has repeatedly done. On the surface, The Psychology of Final Fantasy, Surpassing the Limit Break, is an exploration of the connections between classical psychological theory, the latest psychological findings, and Final Fantasy. In reality, The Psychology of Final Fantasy, Surpassing the Limit Break, is the result of the mission to define a cultural juggernaut. It is a valuable insight into the human condition, for that's where we begin to explore ourselves and how Final Fantasy has defied limits by shaping culture and becoming its own. It is a testament to not just the evolution of a series, but also of a medium and the people who have pushed it forward as creators, critics, consumers, and fans. It is a fragment of what it means to be a Final Fantasy, and what that means to so many of us. It is no easy task. It is difficult to define what it means to just me as a longtime fan, to illustrate its effect on my politics, views, and self-image. In a world where change is perhaps the only consistent phenomenon throughout the lives of billions of people, Final Fantasy has been a rare constant. It's why I fell in love with storytelling and am the first person in my family to go to college and dream of working in the video games industry. Why I can provide for my family as a journalist who has written for publications like Vice, PC Gamer, Polygon, and many others. How, on the most difficult days, it has been one of my sources of escapism, joy, and comfort. This is only one story among millions across different cultures, languages, locations, and eras. I hope this book provides you the tools to help you use the lens and legacy of Final Fantasy to define yours. Sincerely, Natalie Flores, journalist. Introduction. The battle appears lost. Two members of your party are incapacitated, and you are running low on everything. Supplies, magic, health, and the enemy, an evil so powerful that left unchecked will destroy the world, is about to strike again. You have spent countless hours to reach this point in the game. Thinking that the end is near, you contemplate retreat. Maybe I will never beat this game, says a voice somewhere in your own mind. But then it happens. Your main damage dealer hits their limit break. Suddenly, a sense of relief washes over you, and with that relief, a new sense of confidence. The thought, I can win this battle, comes softly at first, but quickly turns into a rallying cry. You access the now available limit break menu and deal a critical hit to the enemy. Yes! This was the break you needed. You quickly take another turn before the monster can attack and heal the rest of your party. After several more rounds of battle, you ultimately defeat the enemy and the game, completing a long journey feeling satisfied and accomplished. Final Fantasy is one of the longest-running video game series of all time, with the first game released in 1987 and the latest release as of this publication in April 2020. For over three decades, players have immersed themselves into the various worlds, kingdoms, planets, and moons of the series, assembling a team of adventurers that inevitably must save the day from an unimaginable evil. I would imagine that many of those players have had a similar experience to the one described above. Countless battles within Final Fantasy have been won or made trivial thanks to the Limit Break. The Limit Break is a gameplay mechanic that was introduced to the series in Final Fantasy VII. Every character that the player controls in the game has a meter that fills up when the character takes damage from an enemy attack. Once the meter is full, the character hits their limit and is presented with a menu that features a special attack options and other actions specific to each character. While the limit break is an important feature of gameplay for the series, it also speaks to something deeper about human psychology, for it is only by taking damage that you can unlock a character's full abilities. In other words, the characters transform their trauma into actions that are productive and meaningful, rather than succumbing to their potentially deleterious effects, making the name for this book Surpassing the Limit Break that more powerful. The collection of essays in this book connects this and other facets of Final Fantasy to psychological concepts and theories, unraveling the complex psychological appeal of the series. The stories of Final Fantasy run the gamut from tales of medieval knights and wizards to sci-fi and high-tech adventures, but uniting them all is a way of telling stories that focuses on building characters from the bottom up, rather than presenting them as a complete being, a technique that promotes intimate connection with the characters and draws players more deeply into the story. That deep connection with the story is made stronger by the music composed for the series. Composer Nobuo Uematsu's music helps to express the emotional connection players often experience while playing the games and when they hear the music in other places outside of the games. Final Fantasy stories also share the same metaplot of good versus evil, whether that evil manifests itself as a villain bent on shaping the world in their own image, or generally as the effects of evil advancing technology in a manner to control everyone and take away their individuality. In one game from the series, Final Fantasy X, the villain takes the form of the leader of a religious cult, exploring ideas of cognitive dissonance that often result from these extreme religious experiences and problematic belief patterns. Crystals also play an important role in almost every game of the series, representing spiritual and elemental harmony. It is typically the restoration and the use of the crystals that restores order and good to the world, as it is so prevalent in the game series of Final Fantasy. Another integral part of the game series is the ability to pick and choose the members of your party. These are the characters a player can directly control while in battle with enemies, each with unique abilities. But what does Gestalt psychology reveal about the process of these single individual characters becoming members of the unified whole? Do the characters you choose to play as represent a psychological aspect of our personality? These characters are often representative of various races, genders, and even species. But why do we choose specific ones, and what is the impact on us? Women also play a particularly important role in many of the games as powerful warrior characters, but they do not always start off as strong and require the flow of their own journey to discover who they are. Gender stereotypes, however, are just as important to discuss in the series, as many roles typically thought of as feminine, the healer, for example, are portrayed primarily by women, yet have a deeper meaning if we are to take a closer look at them. Ultimately, each character's individual path or destiny is revealed through that character's own actions and self-reflection, giving meaning to their life and choices, especially in the eyes of Vivi Ornitter, which is discussed in depth within the book. Final Fantasy has been and continues to be a touchstone series for fans of role-playing games. Its continued popularity makes a discussion of the psychology in the game that is much more important as it touches the lives of so many individuals again and again. Understanding the psychology of Final Fantasy provides valuable insights for those that play the series and for those who seek a more critical understanding of the psychological concepts in games. We are what we play, and that play is important to our understanding of each other, ourselves, and our future. I hope you can find the same enjoyment in reading his book that the authors experience while playing, reliving, and writing about these games. Sean Atkinson, PhD, Associate Professor of Music Theory at Texas Christian University. The Storytelling of Final Fantasy by Rachel Cowart. Now is the time to shape your stories. Your fate is in your hands. Auron from Final Fantasy X. Narsh, Midgar, Besaid. To those who have played Final Fantasy, these city names likely conjure images of architecture, specific music, and a range of emotions. This is because these are some of the places where the stories of Final Fantasy have taken place. These vast worlds with unknown plants and animals, strange customs, and new races immerse its players into their unfamiliar lands. These worlds seem overwhelming on the onset, but by the time the players reach the end, they likely feel like they have known this world and the characters within it for their whole life. This is due to the rich storytelling of the games within the Final Fantasy franchise. It is impossible to begin a discussion about Final Fantasy without discussing its storytelling, with narratives revolving around grandiose stories of good versus evil. Final Fantasy has allowed us to witness heroic battles, experience hard-won victories, and create treasured friendships for almost 40 years. The franchise contains more than a dozen worlds, hundreds of beloved heroes and villains, and an innumerable number of memorable monsters. Knowing this, it is perhaps no surprise that Final Fantasy is one of the most beloved series of role-playing games. Originally released in 1987, Final Fantasy broke the mold with full-motion videos, fully orchestrated scores, and daring and complex narratives. Epic tales could take 100 hours or more to fully explore all from the 8-bit glory of the original Nintendo gaming system. It is worth noting that this kind of game-making was unprecedented at the time, considering that the other popular 1986 titles had limited narratives, including the boxing-themed sports game Punch-Out from Nintendo, and the classic beat-em-up game Double Dragon from Tecmo's Japan. Exploring the rich storytelling of Final Fantasy illustrates how this series of games has provided some of the most beloved and memorable characters and narratives in video game history. Final Fantasy has built and continues to build their characters through the use of a Kishoten Ketsu story structure. Furthermore, The series has provided transitional insight into Japanese culture by integrating themes of Bushido within their characters, stories, and throughout the powerful roles women have been given in their games, all within the Kishotenketsu story structure. Building structure with Kishotenketsu. When the tales of Final Fantasy come up in conversation, you can expect that it will soon turn into a discussion of characters. Cloud, Aerith, Yuna, Tidus, and every iteration of Cid. The characters of Final Fantasy stick with us like old friends or beloved family members. Of all of the Final Fantasy's innovations, it is the bottom-up, character-driven storytelling that truly sets Final Fantasy apart from its cohorts. For within each new iteration of the series, the writers weave elaborate tales of heroism, strife, loss, and redemption, and good versus evil through a four-part Kishotenketsu structure, also known as introduction, development, plot, twist, and conclusion. This style of mythos-making is often found in East Asian storytelling, though less often seen in the medium of video games. Whilst Final Fantasy is not the only game series to use this kind of storytelling, they have certainly mastered the craft. Kishotenketsu's storytelling structure is based in Chinese, Korean, and Japanese cultural narratives. It is comprised of an introduction, development, twist, and conclusion to tell a complete story, focusing on protagonists and their specific plights found within their environment. This style of storytelling is psychologically compelling as it allows the player to build a connection with their characters from the bottom up rather than top down, as is common in Western storytelling. Building from the bottom up refers to the fact that the narratives of Final Fantasy focus on the stories of each individual character from the outset, rather than the overarching conflict. This allows for the player to feel bonded with the characters in a way that might be similar to a real-world friend or family member. The narratives focus on individual characters' background, motivations, and goals, long before revealing the overarching conflict at hand. For example, in Final Fantasy VI, players learn how Celeste and Terra were both trained by Kefka, the primary antagonist of the story, about the murder of Locke and Cyan's families, and the familiar conflicts between Edgar and Sabin, long before they learn about how these characters will come together, or Kefka's ultimate plan to destroy the world. This kind of bottom-up storytelling is further reiterated in the third-person perspectives of Final Fantasy, where the player becomes more of an outside force influencing the interactions between several individuals, rather than the experience of any one or sole character. This kind of storytelling is in stark contrast to the traditional Western narrative structures. In Western storytelling, the narrative typically revolves around a central conflict that needs to be resolved, often a person or force that must be defeated. For example, from the very beginning in Skyrim, a Bethesda Game Studio video game, the player is told that they must find and defeat the World Eater Dragon. From then on, every interaction revolves around achieving that goal. The focus on the overarching conflict, rather than the group narrative, is also reflected in the primary reliance on first-person perspective. The players engage with the game from the role of the protagonist. The components of Kishotenketsu in Final Fantasy. As stated before, there are four primary components to traditional Kishotenketsu storytelling, making the story compelling, emotional, and immersive. The four components of Kishotenketsu are introduction, ki, development, sho, twist, ten, and conclusion, ketsu. In the first component, introduction, ki, the characters, setting, situation, and other basic elements of the story are established. Next is the development, sho, phase, which is an expansion of the first act or introduction. The characters, setting, and other basic elements of the story are elaborated upon, but no major plot changes occur. This is followed by the twist, ten. The story takes a turn into a seemingly separate situation. This third act is a clear departure from the character setup in the first and second acts, and is a complication in the overall storyline, not necessarily a conflict. The twist here may also be a shift in setting or focus that will bear some relevance to establishing the resolution of the journey in the fourth act. Last is the conclusion, Ketsu. This is where the story resolves and all the acts become connected, including the third act, to resolve the narrative established in the first part of the video game story. This style of storytelling uniquely allows for the development of plot lines of individual characters long before a major conflict or plot twist is revealed, providing players with the opportunity to connect with the game's characters before learning how they are linked together and or how they will work together to solve the overarching conflict at hand. To further illustrate how this story structure has been integrated into the narratives of Final Fantasy, the following section will highlight the narratives of Final Fantasy VI as an example. Kishoten Ketsu in Final Fantasy VI. Delving deeper in the narratives of Final Fantasy VI helps illustrate the use of bottom-up storytelling through a Kishoten Ketsu structure. Final Fantasy VI begins by exploring the storyline of Terra, a former member of Kefka's, the antagonist, army. Terra is struggling with the decision to continue fighting with the army or to break away and forge her own path and destiny. Early on, players also explore the storylines of Locke, a treasure hunter, Edgar, king of Figaro, and Edgar's brother Sabin. Mog, a talking Moogle, is also introduced. It is important to note that the introduction of these characters happens relatively independently. The story begins centered on Terra. She soon encounters Locke, who helps her travel south to meet Edgar and Sabin. The introduction of these characters and initial meetings make up the introduction, key, stage of the narrative. Then, the narrative transitions into the development show stage. During this time, we are introduced to several new characters, Celeste, a formal general in Kefka's army, and Cyan, a mercenary driven for revenge for the murder of his family by Kefka's army. While Locke meets Celeste and brings her into the fold of the rebellion, also known as those fighting against the antagonist, Cyan is adventuring all on his own. Shortly after his introduction, he crosses paths with Sabin, and together they encounter a new character, a feral child named Gao. During this narrative stage, we learn little that progresses the overall story. Instead, we are digging deeper into individual characters' storylines, creating the backstory for the group composition. Then the story progresses into the twist, 10, where we see a shift in focus away from forming a group to resist Kefka's army and towards uncovering the nature of Terra's magical powers. In a climactic moment, Terra turns glowing pink and then flies away. For the next several hours of the game, the narrative turns away from the villainous Kefka and towards finding Terra. The groups explore various corners of the world to find her, and during this time undergo several side quests, such as the famous opera storyline featuring Celeste and Locke, that are mostly irrelevant to the game's primary plot. Despite the group's looming final battle with Kefka, there are several other climactic moments spread throughout the narrative in the twist, 10. The murder of Cyan's family, and the potential losses of Shadow and Mog, depending on the player's in-game choices, to name a couple. During this time, players are also introduced to a new character, an airship owner named Selzer. This section's progression ends with a return to the main storyline of the rise of Kefka. In an attempt to end the conflict, Celeste tries to murder Kefka but fails. Kefka continues to decimate cities and strike down anyone who opposes his rule. In the fray, the player's airship is destroyed and all the characters scatter across the globe. This begins the conclusion, Ketsu, stage of the story. It begins with Celeste, alone on an island, and the introduction of a new character, Cid. Celeste leaves the island, reunites with Sabin, and together they reassemble the cast of allies. This undertaking takes them through more troublesome adventures, but they stay focused upon the final goal. In the end, they find Kefka, defeat him, and the party flies across the world to witness the celebratory rebuilding of the cities and towns that Kefka had destroyed. The use of a Kishoten Ketsu in Final Fantasy creates game space where the player feels invested in and integral to the success of the characters within it. While saving the world and contemplating the overarching conflict is important, What truly resonates are the characters, their relationships with each other, and their place in this fantasy world. Even in Final Fantasy VI, a significant proportion of time is given to finding and understanding Terra, rather than actively progressing towards prevailing over Kefka. In Final Fantasy, it is just as much, if not more, about the characters and their relationships than resolving the overarching conflict. The focus on the collective relationships, rather than the individual's fight for glory, is not only a byproduct of the storytelling structure of Final Fantasy, but also one of the ways it provides transitional insight into the Japanese culture in which it is created. The power of Bushido. In addition to the use of a traditionally Eastern storytelling structure, the storytelling of Final Fantasy provides unique transitional insight and a cross-cultural understanding by highlighting the tenets of Bushido, the way of the warrior in Japanese culture, loyalty, duty, and honor. These tenets are prevalent in many of the game's character arcs as well as the overarching narratives interwoven throughout the games in the series. While the central narratives of Final Fantasy have consistently remained a broad battle between good and evil, despite the idiosyncrasies of the particular stories, many characters struggle internally between taking actions that are in line with what they believe is the right thing to do, in other words, rebuke Kefka's cruel reign or succumb to it, and what is their duty to maintain their honor, in other words, defeat Kefka because he is the head of the ruling army or fight back. For example, the dialogue of Cloud Strife, the primary protagonist of Final Fantasy VII, regularly emphasizes his inner conflict about doing what is right rather than what is expected of him as a soldier turned mercenary. These themes of Bushido are carried in Cloud's dialogue throughout the game, touching on all three themes of loyalty. I decided to live for the both of us. Duty. Anyone may claim that he will act in the direst of times, yet only a brave man acts in times, great and small. And honor. I want to be forgiven. Yes, I want to be forgiven. Similarly, Terra Branford, a protagonist of Final Fantasy VI, is conflicted as to whether she should help the allies battle the primary antagonist, Kefka, as she was formerly a soldier in his army. The supporting characters also struggle with this inner conflict of following the Bushido Code. For example, also in Final Fantasy VI, Edgar Fagaro, the King of Fagaro, publicly maintains a strong allegiance to the ruling empire, the Gastalian Empire, despite their atrocities because he believes this is his duty as king and what is necessary to maintain his honor. However, he is secretly providing support and aid to the rebel group that seeks to liberate the various city-states from the oppression of the Gastalians. Throughout the game, the actions and dialogue of Edgar largely center on his inner conflict between what is good and what is just and what is honorable. The consistent use of the tenets of Bushido in character and narrative design within the games of the Final Fantasy franchise provides significant insight into what is valued within Japanese culture. Being a loyal companion, ruler, and soldier is one's duty, whether they be prescribed via birthright, appointment, or occupation, and, above all else, maintaining honor. These values are deeply rooted in Japanese culture, and starkly contrast to the values related to individualism typically exhausted in Western cultures and Western video games, such as Skyrim. The Women of Final Fantasy. Many installments within the Final Fantasy franchise feature strong, competent female combatants such as Terra and Celeste in Final Fantasy VI, Yuna in Final Fantasy X, and Lightning from Final Fantasy XIII. Final Fantasy was ahead of its time in enlisting female protagonists, as well as portraying them as powerful leaders. The lack of female characters in games is a disparity that remains prevalent within the video game industry today. In general, female characters are largely underrepresented in video games. One of the first reports in 2001 on female characters in video games reported that 16% of all video game characters were female, with 50% of them being props or bystanders. Similarly, in 2002, it was found that only around 14% of in-game characters were female. Of the few female characters, and even fewer female protagonists that do exist, they are often portrayed in ways that are different to their male counterparts. In other words, less clothing, more skin exposure, sexualized more than male characters. Final Fantasy was and continues to be groundbreaking in their inclusion of female protagonists, as well as with the narratives that were created around them. In an era where their female video game cohorts were typically damsels in distress, for example, Princess Peach from Super Mario World, the females of Final Fantasy are less known for their costumes, as has been the standard for female characters and many other franchises and genre categories of video games, and more so for their strength and leadership. This is in contrast to the typically male-centric narratives that have historically dominated video games. The portrayal of women as leaders, rather than damsels in distress or background decoration, among other common tropes, directly conflicts with the values of traditional Japanese culture, in which women held positions of power long before their Western counterparts. For example, the first ruling empress of Japan, Empress Suiko, reigned from 593 to 628 AD. The roles of women in the franchise is just another example of the transitional insight players garner through the complex narratives of the Final Fantasy franchise. Ketsu. The storytelling of Final Fantasy is one of the reasons it is consistently listed as one of the top role-playing franchises of all time. The bottom-up, character-driven storylines established through a Kisho Tenketsu structure, the incorporation of the tenets of Bushido, and the powerful role of women are some of the franchise's key features across iteration. Understanding the importance of this style of psychological storytelling is key to understanding the psychological draw and longevity of these games. While it may be the battle between good and evil that initially draws us in, it is the character relationships, inner struggles, and cultural insight that keep us there. These games are not only a compelling form of entertainment, but as players, we grow, change, and learn from these narratives. Role-playing games are vehicles of transitional insight and interpersonal transformation. The traditional storytelling of Final Fantasy transports players to a world where they experience the inner conflict of loyalty, duty, and honor, see strong female leaders leading groups of men, and become emotionally invested in the outcomes of the characters. These digital adventures not only stay with us, but like a good book or film, but have the ability to change us and our ideas about who we are and how we operate in the world. Through these creative narratives and story characters, Final Fantasy can help us better understand ourselves and the nature of the world and our place in it through its imagery and emotional inspiration. In these ways, the storytelling of Final Fantasy has had a significant influence on its players, gaming cultures, and the gaming industry as a whole. The traditional storytelling and transitional themes are interwoven into each chapter of the Final Fantasy universe, and are the foundation that each game is built upon. As you explore the following pages of this book, remember that beloved worlds, characters, and stories of Final Fantasy were built on a foundation of traditional Eastern storytelling and transitional components.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.